to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
O Christ our God, make us worthy of this Hosanna Sunday to go out to meet you with your glorious second coming. Just as the crowds went out to meet you at your first coming, they carried palms and olive branches while shouting, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord to save and renew us. To you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit be glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with the church and her children.
While the church sings praises, they glory, Zion and Austin. All sing praise to him, and Hosanna they proclaim. When the Turin cries, the shepherd comes for all people. Zion answers, Moses alone is our shepherd. When the church cries, a light has dawned on creation. Zion answers, we need no light to light our paths. Rise, Zechariah, rise. Sing your praises. Your words are fulfilled. On a cold field, Lord God, rise. Prophets, apostles, children, and infants, all sing praise to him.
Christ, you are pleasing to the Father who sent you, and you are the pure incense who has made creation fragrant, bringing joy to the world. You fulfilled what was said by the prophets, and you delighted by the praise of the children. May we rejoice in the sweetness of your love. Make our souls and senses fragrant with the purity of your holiness, so that we may praise and thank you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, forever.
Until the day of Christ Jesus. It is right that I should think this way about all of you, because I hold you in my heart. You are all partners with me in grace, both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel. For God is my witness, how I long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may increase ever more and more in knowledge and every kind of perception to discern what is of value, so that you may be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ, for the glory and praise of God. I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that my situation has turned out rather to advance the gospel, so that my imprisonment has become well known in Christ throughout the whole Praetorium.
Praise be to God always.
Praise and blessings to Jesus Christ, our Lord and our God.
things his disciples did not know at first. But when Jesus had been glorified, then they remembered that these things had been written about him. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Of course, on this great moment of Hosanna Sunday, we open this evening this whole, the great and holy week of the Passion. We consider our Lord's suffering, but what we actually are contemplating is, what is love? What are the attributes, what are the qualities of love? Love is a word that we throw around quite often. It's easy. But in English, love can mean anything from self-sacrificing, noble, giving love, devotion, to a weekend fling on a Friday night. And love encompasses this whole spectrum from the most base and kind of bestial to very, very beautiful and noble. When we speak about love in the context of what God brings in the person of our Lord Jesus Christ, it's actually more appropriate that we use the word charity. Charity, we think of giving things to people who are poor. But charity is a much higher elevated idea that when our Lord came to this world, where God entered into history, it was to show us what the divine love, what God is by nature, his very being, so that he may allow us to participate in that divine love, share it with those around us, and that together we find this a link with our Father in heaven and with our Savior. So we glorify our Lord's Passion because it becomes the apogee. It's the pinnacle that shows to us what love is in its qualities. And at the same time, what is emphasized by this gospel today is the kind of cluelessness of the people. There is a great celebration that goes on around our Lord. They receive him, Hosanna. Hosanna, we call this Hosanna Sunday. And Hosanna is from the Aramaic, the Hebrew. It's an exclamation, not. It's an acclamation and an exclamation. But the word originally means save us. Hosanna. Hosanna has an original meaning. So this crying out to the people, the Syriac fathers take as an understanding that this is actually the celebration of God's entrance into the world. And as St. Ephrem writes in his poems, that our Lord on this day opens a new road into the holy city of God. It isn't just that they leave Bethphage and go down the valley of Josaphat and come up and enter into Jerusalem. That's a historical moment. But St. Ephrem says that on Hosanna Sunday, what God himself is doing incarnate is opening an entire new path to us. And that it has a whole cosmological, cosmic aspect of the redemption of the universe, bringing it back into the full healing of God's love, which originally created. That was the intention of God in his divine goodness and his charity that he created this world. So that Saint Jacob of Sarug, in his writings, he says that on this day the whole of nature gives thanks to you because it has been renewed by you. He points out that what we're celebrating is why it's joyous in the Syriac tradition. No one except the Syrian influence throughout Egypt, Ethiopia, and the Syrian plains. Hosanna Sunday, other than the Syrian tradition, the Hosanna Sunday does not stand in the same kind of pinnacle of the creation of the newness and the opening of the road in that affirmation, save us, renew us, make us new again. But what makes us new is the divine love, charity which is given to us so that we as individuals can come to the point to love with the love that is God's love. Now, as I mentioned, that one of the things that St. John points out here is his disciples don't understand. That means as a human level, they understand what's going on. And in fact, Judas, for one of them, is quite happy. Finally, the rabbi is getting recognition. But it's all on a human level. And we're told explicitly by St. John, many of the people that come out are there for curiosity. Because Lazarus is in this crowd too. A few weeks ago, Lazarus was raised from the tomb. Raised from the dead, the people who had seen this miracle were told explicitly by St. John today that they continued to give testimony to that fact. The people come to see this. In the Gospel of St. Matthew, we're told that as our Lord begins in Bethphage to go down the valley of Josaphat, that the people also come out of Jerusalem. So there's a huge entourage in front of our Lord, behind our Lord, around our Lord, bringing him into and ushering him into Jerusalem. And since the temple is on this side of the city, the priests in the temple couldn't do anything else except to see this great movement coming into the city. So they're furious. They've tried everything they could to cut out this man. At the Passover was a moment when people came from all around the empire. And they came because the faithful Jews had to be present at the temple on 3 days. Passover, the Feast of Pentecost, and the Feast of Booths, Tabernacles. These 3 days, which is why we also have, we're told, these Greeks come. These Greeks are not Israelites by birth, but they're called God-fearers. They're proselytes. They're people who came in a conversion to the law of Moses. Most of them did not become fully people of Israel because as an adult, the idea of circumcision just kind of makes you wince. And so they go to the edge, they follow the laws, they were there for the worship of the temple, they follow the moral law of God, they follow the testimony of Moses, and they are the ones who are here as part of this huge crowd. This easily the size of Jerusalem would double, be well over 500,000 people during this week for the Passover. That's why there are huge crowds everywhere. And they are the ones who come to Philip. Because Philip is a Greek name, Philippos, love of horses. And so they come to Philip and they say, we'd like to see the rabbi. And of course, our gospel today cuts off at that point. But it's the famous gospel that certainly you all know, in which our Lord, he doesn't even address the Greeks, he just starts speaking of the apostles there. When he says that the grain that remains alone, the wheat that remains alone, dies. But if the grain is sown and dies in the earth, it flourishes and brings forth fruit 100-fold. And then he says, should I ask for this hour to pass? But indeed, this is the reason why I came into the world. So the gospel itself is showing us, our Lord is very clear what's going on here, of course. But the people around him don't really understand what's happening. We're told, as is said by St. John, that only the apostles think of these things later, after the resurrection, what this truly meant, Hosanna Sunday. So what we're contemplating here is the fact that when our Lord is entering into Jerusalem, in the Gospel of St. Luke, we're also told that while everyone else is shouting and cheering and pulling down branches and throwing them in the ground and laying their cloaks down on the road, our Lord weeps over Jerusalem. Because as he comes down the valley of Josaphat, you can see Jerusalem opposite the valley as you go down and come up to the city. There is a church on Mount Olivet. This is Mount Olivet. Bethphage is on Mount Olivet that comes down. And on the side of Mount Olivet, there is a church called Dominus Flavit. And in Latin, this title means the Lord wept. And the church was built in the beginning of the 20th century. And it's kind of an unusual building because the roof is round. It's kind of a rounded top building that comes down square. The top is rounded because it's meant to architecturally represent a teardrop. Because it represents from the Gospel of St. Luke that as the people were crying out and having a glorious time, our Lord was crying because he knew what the holy city was going to do in 5 days' time. And he says that Jerusalem, if only you knew the time of your visitation, but you would not. You would not accept this moment. So in this church, and of course it's built in the days when we all faced the right direction together. So you had priest, altar, priest, and everyone behind him all facing over the altar. Over the altar there is a large window Because, of course, being on Mount Olivet, it faces out to see the city of Jerusalem. And there's a large window over the altar. That frame is like a wrought iron black crown of thorns that goes all the way around, that frames the window. And in the center is a wrought iron chalice and host. So that as you were offering the Divine Eucharist, the people, the priest, could all see out this window, the place of Jerusalem, as they offered the Eucharistic sacrifice of our Lord's death and resurrection. It's a very moving, very small church, but very beautiful, but commemorating the fact that our Lord is never carried away by the jubilation of the people who are somewhat clueless around him. So when we look at the question of the love, the charity which our Lord is doing, we have four qualities that we contemplate this week. And that charity, we know in the scriptures, that charity shows forth, firstly, attachment. There is engagement. There is an act of the will for the sake of the one that we love, and we make choices, and we choose to do things. It's not, feelings are part of what happened. They just happen to us. But the mind, the will, the intellect, choice, free will. The charity, one of the things that our Lord is determined to enter the city, even though he weeps over it, knowing that exactly the same people who are screaming and jumping up and down today are going to be screaming for his death in 5 days. It's the same people. Our Lord is under no illusion. And yet, charity makes us be engaged for the sake of the beloved. The second aspect of charity is there is a sense of warmth, not in feeling, but in the sense of hospitality, receptiveness. When we love in charity, we are open to receive from the other. And our Lord, he uses the image over Jerusalem. I would have been like a mother hen, taking her chicks under my wings, but you didn't want any of this. So the second aspect of charity is that it's receptive, it's open, and it's warm in that sense of hospitality. The third quality is that charity always bears respect. Charity brings a sense of esteem in the one that we love. It's something that we don't often think of in the modern world. But as the turmoil that churns through us by the wounds of original sin, we spend most of our time trying to make other people do what we want them to do. We are, by the wounds of original sin, very manipulative. So we're always trying to make our spouse, our children, our parents, our friends, our family, do what we want them to do, and of course when they don't, we get ticked off. Charity in its truth acts upon with a quality of respect and esteem of the other. That's why our Lord doesn't do anything in the midst of all of this week which would injure anyone in their free will of the engagement of the choices they make over these next 5 days. And then lastly, the quality that we have in charity is it sees. Charity has eyes and vision to see truth. And for that reason, it has been inspired by the spirit of gratitude, of thanksgiving for the things that we have received. Our tendency, again, by the wounds of original sin, is to see what we don't have, so that we whine and we complain. And we're always miserable because we can always find something that we'd like to have different. But charity sees what is good. Charity esteems what is around it and ultimately sees the hand of God and what is received and its benefits from God. So it has charity in its presence within us, always brings that aspect and quality of a profound sense of gratitude. So over these last 40 days of Lent, we have been meant to be looking at our individual personal lives. Where charity is absent, where our souls are wounded, where our minds are ignorant, injured. And we look during this week to see how God will show forth day after day. As we said, tonight at 6 p.m., we will open up the week of the Passion with the rite and the ceremony called Coming into the Harbor. Just prayers, hymns, we don't get anything, there's no palms. We don't get anything to carry away. But we open up the entire week asking God to open our minds to contemplate this profound mystery of the renewal of the cosmos, the opening of the new path in the city of God. And we ask that charity be given to us as our rule of life, ultimately. Because ultimately, charity is the only thing by which we will be judged. When we die, the influence and the quality of our life will be judged based upon how much we have been modified, transformed, and ultimately transfigured by divine charity. Which is why the last point is a reminder. And you all know about Thursday night and Friday. Though someday we're going to talk about the rite of the signing of the chalice on Good Friday that takes place at noon. It's one of the most ancient and most beautiful of our ceremonies. Your children shouldn't be in school on Good Friday. Everybody should be here at noon. Make your choices. But in the evening, you know the burial and death of our Lord, so we don't need to talk about that. But on Saturday at noon, there is the rite of the forgiveness. We talked about the rite of the Lamb last week. The forgiveness and awaiting the great light. It's a ceremony which takes place midday, which begins penitentially, ends, it's about an hour, and then ends with the resurrection and glory of our Lord. It actually initiates and opens our celebration of the resurrection. But it is the rite of forgiveness. The sacrament of penance will be available. These praises that we will have, because what we finish by doing on that Saturday midday is that after these 40-some days, when we recognize that our selfishness by the mercy of God is forgiven, that our wounded love itself has been healed by this Hosanna, and that our reintegrated charity at that point, on the Saturday of the Great Light, has been universalized, elevated, as we await for that light which has risen from the grave. It is proper to our Syriac tradition, that ceremony. The other churches don't do anything on Holy Saturday. But the Syriacs gather already in acknowledgement of the mercies of God, and that what Hosanna is this cosmic renewal. So let us ask God for the generosity this week to put ourselves faithfully on this path to contemplate divine love, the transformation of charity that our Lord shows in his Passion during this great week. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Please stand.
Jesus Christ, our Lord, the Son of God, stretch forth your right hand and bless these branches here, prepared for your people, for the sake of your holy name. We call out to you in prayer, O Lord, hear us.
O Lord of heavenly powers, the seraphim and cherubim, and the angels and archangels, and all spiritual beings tremble before you. They cover their eyes before your majesty. They worship you with reverence and awe and glorify you without ceasing. Here on earth you are praised by infants, children, and all the faithful with shouts of Hosanna. We implore you, O Lord, to pardon our faults in your grace and to forgive our offenses in your mercy. May we live according to your will and find mercy and compassion in this world and in the next. O Lord, our God, to you be glory forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads before the Lord.
In the end. now in your abundant mercy. Bless these branches that we may bless these branches that they may bless those who carry them and take them. May they educate children, strengthen the young, and give dignity to the elderly. May churches, monasteries, and convents and homes be filled with their blessings. May they confirm the faithful in the true faith and in good works. Glory, honor, and adoration are due to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
May these sacred branches be blessed and sanctified in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Deliver us from the trials of temptation that we do not have the strength to overcome. Confirm us in the true faith. Fill us with love for you and for each other. And ground us in hope by your divine blood, which you shed for our salvation. By your grace and through the intercession of your holy and blessed Mother, guard and protect all Christians who celebrate this feast. Have mercy on the faithful departed who have gone to their rest, hoping in you, and may they dwell in your heavenly kingdom, rejoicing with you forever.
Thank you.
accept these offerings that your children have brought to you. Father, their love for you and for your holy name, shower your spiritual blessings upon them, and in place of their earthly gifts, grant them life in your kingdom.
Amen.
As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ and his plan of salvation for us, we recall upon his offspring all those who have pleased God from heaven to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, Saint Mary, Saint Jude, and Saint Charbel. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers, and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom the sacrifice is offered, for the intentions of all the members of this parish. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering. world to bring the lost sheep back to you. Do not turn your face away from us as we celebrate this spiritual and bloodless sacrifice. Relying upon your mercy and through the grace of your only Son, we ask that this mystery be instituted for our salvation, not for our condemnation. Rather, may it blot out our sins, forgive our faults, and be an expression of our thanks for your goodness. We glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The love of God, the Father, and the grace of the only begotten Son, and the communion and indwelling of the Holy Spirit, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let us lift up our thoughts, our minds, and our hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord with reverence and worship Him with humility.
He is right and just.
Truly it is right and just to glorify you, bless you, praise you, adore you, and give you thanks, O Maker of all things visible and invisible. The highest heavens and all its powers praise you, the sun and the moon and all the stars, the earth, the seas and all that is in them, the heavenly Jerusalem and the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven. The angels, archangels and heavenly hosts all sing, praising your majestic glory with triumphant hymns. With never-ending voices and with acclamations, they cry out and they proclaim.
Hamro min mayo Francis, the Pope of Rome, the Shadow Peter, our Patriarch of Antioch,
Nostrada Peter, our retired patriarch, Gregory John, our bishop, and all the orders of the church and those who serve. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, our parents and all our brothers and sisters, those who are praying here with us and those who are not here. For those who have asked us to remember them in our prayers, answer the petitions that will lead to their salvation. Remember those who have presented offerings upon your holy altar, those for whom they have been offered, and those who have desired to make an offering but were unable, those whom we have remembered, and those whom we have not. Reward them with the joy of your salvation, and accept their offering upon your heavenly altar. We pray to you, O Lord. Stand for justice and establish peace. Remember also captives and prisoners, the sick, the suffering, and the afflicted, the needy, and those who labor in all walks of life. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, all those who have pleased you from the beginning, the holy, glorious, ever-Virgin Mary, the patriarchs, prophets, apostles, St. John the Forerunner, St. Stephen the Archdeacon and First Martyr, St. James the Brother of the Lord, St. Joseph, St. Jude, St. Maron, and St. Charbel, and all the saints, in your grace count us among them in your church of the firstborn, who are enrolled in heaven. We pray to you, O Lord. Remember, O Lord, the fathers and teachers who spread the word of truth in your holy church and preached your Son, Jesus Christ, to all nations. Through their prayers, grant peace to your church and confirm their teaching in our souls. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O God, of all spiritual and earthly beings, the faithful departed who have died in the true faith. Grant them rest, and do not take their faults into account. Through our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ, who is without sin, we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs.
Grant rest, O God, to the departed, and forgive the sins we have committed, with or without full knowledge.
Grant us pardon, O God, and forgive us of the departed, so that your blessed name may be glorified in us and in all things. With the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was in heaven, shall be forever. Amen.
Father of mercies and God of all consolation,
You have sanctified the offerings and the gifts presented to you, and have perfected them by the grace of your only Son and by the descent of your Holy Spirit. Sanctify us so that with pure hearts and enlightened souls, we may call upon you, Holy Father, God of heaven, praying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Yes, O Lord our God, lead us not into temptation that we do not have the strength to endure. When we are tempted, deliver us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
And peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us bow our heads before the God of mercy, before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, who gives life to those who partake of it, and receive the blessing from the Lord.
O Lord, we bow our heads before you, awaiting your abundant mercy. Send your blessings upon us and sanctify us, so that we may become worthy to share in your holy mysteries. Through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and his mercy and love for all people, you are blessed and glorified with him and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the most holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit. Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility, and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth. To him be glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins and for our new life. O Lord our God, to you be the glory forever.
Thank you.
you, O God the Father, for your great and indescribable love for all people. Since you have made us worthy to share in your whole heavenly banquet and in your Holy Spirit, do not forsake us for having received your holy mysteries, but keep us in the radiance of holiness and righteousness. With the saints, may we obtain a share of the heavenly reward in the grace of your only Son and his love for all people. We glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, who is good, life-giving, and consubstantial with you, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Jesus our Lord, protect us, bless us, protect us, and guide us on the path of life. Faithfully remember the departed of those who have shared in this Eucharist that was offered upon this divine altar. Grant protection to the living, and bless them with hope. Through the prayers of the Virgin Mary and of all the saints, now and forever.
Amen.
So, at the end of the Mass, please take freely from the poems that you have in front of the Bema here for the blessings upon your homes. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory.